before starting the actual animal tissue culture work, we need to understand the very important instrument required to carry out this work. The name of the instrument is biosafety cabinet. This cabinet gives us the aseptic area inside to work. Aseptic area means the area which is completely free from any type of the living organisms. This biosafety cabinet is BSL2 type, which has or which maintains positive pressure inside so that no air from outside can enter inside, and there is an exhaust installed outside this biosafety cabinet which filters the air which is coming from inside. If it carries any pathogens, it will get trapped in the filter and the sterile air will be released in the environment. It has a pressure gauge which indicates the pressure. This pressure is for indicating the air which is entering inside, the compressed air, whether it is entering with the required pressure or not, to generate a positive pressure and to carry out the filtration process of air smoothly. When you switch on the blower, you will see the knob inside the pressure valve goes up. This knob, when it reaches to the unit near about to the unit 10, that means the appropriate pressure of air is achieved inside and the filters are working properly. Along with the pressure knob, there are other knobs on the biosafety. One is for daylight, that is a normal light for a working area. The second knob is for ultraviolet light, which is required for surface sterilization of the inside area of biosafety cabinet. And third knob is for blower, which is going to switch on the compressor to enter, to provide the sterile air with the pressure inside the aseptic area, and a main switch which is going to control all three knobs. The inside part is made up of stainless steel. This is a vertical type of biosafety cabinet, and that is why the filters are at the top. You can see a mesh-like structure at the top, which is nothing but an outer covering of a filter. Inside this filter, there are a special type of filters known as HEPA filters, which gives a pore size 0.22 micron and which will not allow the entry of any type of microorganisms inside the aseptic area. Then it has a provision of a plug if any appliance is needed to be used inside. And there is one more section here which is going to release or circulate the compressed air inside to create a positive pressure, and that is why this is called as BSL2 type of cabinet. In BSL1, this provision is not there. Now we are going to start with animal tissue culture work, which is carried out in biosafety cabinet. We have switched on the main switch of the biosafety cabinet. For surface sterilization, we have to switch on the ultraviolet light inside the cabinet for at least 20 minutes. Now we are switching off the UV light after 20 minutes, and we will switch on the visible light and blower inside. Before starting the work, we have to clean the area inside the biosafety cabinet to make it free of any type of living forms. This is an extra precaution because UV light is a weak sterilizing agent. So for cleaning the area, 70% of ethanol or 70% of isopropyl alcohol is used. These cotton swabs are already soaked in 70% of alcohol. You can see the area, especially the working area where the actual experimentation work will be carried out, has to be cleaned properly in each and every corner of the cabinet. All the small instrument, glassware, plasticware, or any minor requirements which are taken inside need to be surface sterilized. The media is having different components depending upon the requirements. Today, the media which we'll be using is DMEM. That is Galbacco's modified Eagle medium. which is a very common medium used for animal tissue culture. Like you see, you have to wipe all the bottles with the ethanol because they are taken out from the fridge. The media and the components need to be kept in the refrigerator because it contains many heat sensitive materials. After wiping all the bottles, we are going to make a complete media. Before that, you have to make aligot, that is a small quantity of each component, because if in future if there is a contamination due to mishandling, only the small quantity, that is the aligot, will get contaminated and your main bottle, the big bottle, will remain safe in the refrigerator, which can be used later. So now you can see the aligots of all the components which we have already made. The first aligot is of DMEM, that is a media which contains all the growth factors, glucose, sodium bicarbonate for maintaining the pH or act as a buffer, and it does not contain the amino acid glutamate, which we will have to add externally. So we have made the aligot of L-glutamine also, which we will be adding in the complete medium. Along with that, we are going to add FBS, which is fetal bovine serum, which gives all the known and unknown micronutrients of the serum to the cells. And the last component is antibiotic. Antibiotic is a optional component. It is not required for the growth of animal cells, but it is added as a safety measure to avoid the contamination. So we have prepared a complete medium. The volume of the medium which we have prepared is 40 ml. So in brief, I'll be telling you how much quantity of the constituents we have added. In the complete medium, we have taken DMEM 36.8 ml, which contains all the nutrients along with the glucose. Then we have added FBS 2 ml, which makes it 5% of FBS. Then we have added glutamine 0.8 ml, which makes its final concentration in the medium 4 millimoles, and its stock is of 200 millimoles. Then we have added antibiotic, which is 100x solution, and in the media we have added 0.4 ml, which makes it 1x. So now our complete medium is ready with all the essential components inside. Along with the media, there is one more solution required, known as trypsin. Trypsin is an enzyme which helps to detach the cells from the substrate, and the cells which are attached to each other, they also get detached after treating them with the trypsin. It is an enzyme. The stock of the trypsin which is available is of 0.25% in EDTA and phosphate buffered saline solution. The stock which is required for trypsinization of the cells is 0.05%. So we have made a working solution of a trypsin by adding 8 ml of stock from the bottle and 32 ml of PBS, that is phosphate buffer saline, which is sterilized, which makes a final working solution of a trypsin 0.05%. In our today's session, we are going to passage A549 cells, which are adenocarcinomic human alveolar basal epithelial cells, which constitute a cell line which was developed in 1972 from an old Caucasian male. This cell line is procured from repository of various cell lines. Before doing the process of passaging, we are going to observe the cells which we have bought from the cell repository under the microscope for their morphology, and then we will proceed further. Because the objectives of this microscope are placed below the stage. You can see the objectives. This is the stage of the microscope, and here below the stage the different types of objectives are placed. The objectives are 4x, 10x, 20x, 45x and 63s. And above the stage you can see there is an attachment for fluorescent filters, and at the side of the microscope there is a camera attached so that the images and the videos, live videos of the cells, can be recorded directly through the camera. Now we are switching on the microscope.
So the adjustment of the camera has been shown on the screen right now. What you can see is the 4x magnification of the cell. We are able to see it on our computer. This is possible because we have a software which is communicating with our hardware. The software is known as Mosaic, M-O-S-A-I-C, Mosaic 2.0 version. And when you just click it out, it is able to communicate with our camera through the USB port. So this is the USB connection which is coming from the camera. The camera has two things. One is the power supply to run it properly, and the second thing is for the data transfer. It is connected through the USB cable. Okay, so just bring the camera near to the screen, please. So what you see here is the small, these spikes are there, which are nothing but our cells, which you have already been informed that they are A549 lung cancer cell lines. And now this is the magnification at 4x power. So we will increase the magnification power, and now it is 10x. So when you change the magnification power, you have to further do some fine adjustment for the sake of clarity. And what you see here are spikes. You can see some spindle shaped bodies. These are the cells which have now adhered to the surface of the tea flask. So they are fully grown cell, you can say, and they are just arranging themselves and packing themselves side by side so that their shapes are changing. Now this magnification power is 20x, so we will be able to see a bigger picture of the cells. What you see in the background, this is spindle shapes. All these are the cells which have got adhered to the surface of the tea flask. Further, what we can do is we can save the images of this magnification for our future reference. So this is the image which I am going to capture at 20x power. Here what you can see, in this part there is a camera icon given there. So we can just click on that camera and we have captured this image which is currently on the screen. We can give the file name and decide the path in which folder we are supposed to save it. So I am choosing desktop at the moment. And this is how you can keep saving all your progress in the form of a soft file in your computer. Observing the cells, now we are going to proceed with passaging of the cells. So we are again one more time disinfecting the working area. Along with that, because we have taken the flask out for observation, so we are again wiping the flask with 70% alcohol. Now this is the flask which we have right now observed under the microscope. You can see it is labeled with the name of the cell line, A549. The passage number is written as N is equal to 39, and the date of the passaging is also written on the flask. Because these cells are already grown in the flask,
for passaging, we are going to remove the media which is already utilized by the cells. For removing the media, we are going to use a sterile pipette which is radiation sterilized, and a pipetting aid which is also called as a SteriPet, which is a chargeable pipetting aid. Now you can see the pipette is attached to a pipetting aid. The pipette is pre-sterilized, so you need to take care it should not touch the any other surface inside the aseptic area. Now slowly you have to open the flask, and with the help of pipetting aid we are going to suck out the media from the flask. As our cells are grown and they are completely attached at the bottom of the flask, they will remain inside the flask. This flask, which is used for growing animal cells, is called as tea flask. Now the media is completely removed. The cells are still attached at the bottom of the flask. Before doing a passaging, we need to detach these cells from the bottom. For the detachment, we are going to use an enzyme trypsin at a concentration of 0.05% in EDTA and phosphate buffer saline. Now we are going to add 2 ml of trypsin solution in a flask. The trypsin is going to act at the bottom and in the surrounding of the cells and dissolve the membrane and help the cells to get detached from the flask surface and from each other, and they get suspended. Now for the enzyme to act, we are going to incubate this flask in the incubator at 37 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes. Before incubation, we are mixing the trypsin with the cells by moving the flask in the infinity shape and making sure the trypsin reaches to the each and every cells which are attached at the bottom. Now we are going to incubate this in 37 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes. We have kept the flask in the incubator. Now we will wait for 5 minutes till the trypsin does its job. To neutralize trypsin, we have to add the media. So we are adding 2 ml of media, that is the equal quantity of the trypsin which we have added. This media will dilute the trypsin and hence stop the action of the trypsin. Now we are going to take this complete content, that is our suspended cells in the media along with the diluted trypsin, in a Falcon tube of 15 ml, and we are going to centrifuge this content to get a cell pellet and remove the trypsin completely. So now we are going to take the complete content of the flask with the help of pipetting aid and add it in a sterile Falcon tube. Falcon tube is a pre-sterilized plastic centrifuge tube with a conical bottom, and it has a graduation markings on it so that while adding you can keep a check on the volume of the constituents you are adding in the tube. So you can see the volume is approximately 4 ml, that means 2 ml trypsin and 2 ml of media which we had added to neutralize the action of the trypsin. Now we are going to centrifuge this in the cooling high-speed centrifuge to get a cell pellet. We have already set the temperature of the centrifuge at 4 degree. So you can see the temperature has come down to 4 degree. And now we are going to centrifuge. One more tube we are keeping for balancing the centrifuge with the same volume of the liquid inside and same weight. Now the RPM or the RCF, that is 200 G, and the time and temperature is already set. So we are going to start the process of centrifugation. Now our centrifugation is done. So we are going to take out the tube. If you see at the bottom, there is a turbid pale colored cells settled at the bottom of the tube, which is a pellet of cells which has settled down. So now we are going to resuspend this pellet and add a fresh medium in it for growth. Before resuspending the cells in a media, we are going to remove the neutralized media and the traces of trypsin, that is a supernatant, from the tube after centrifugation. We are using a micropipette of 1000 microliter. Without disturbing the pellet, the media needs to be removed. You always need to keep one discard container inside the biosafety cabinet to discard the used plasticware or swabs, or to discard the media, and they need to be disinfected and waste disposal should be done according to biosafety norms. So now we are removing the media, that is a supernatant, from the tube. Very slowly you have to remove it so that the pellet should not get disturbed and you should not waste the cells. Now after removing the media, we are going to add fresh complete medium in a tube to resuspend the cells. As we are going to split these cells into two flasks, we are going to add 2 ml of complete medium. After adding the medium, you have to resuspend the cell pellet completely and make sure that there are no clumps of the cells in the resuspended solution. Now we are adding complete medium. 2 ml of medium we are going to add, so that 1 ml will be added in each tea flask. Now before adding the cells, we are going to do the counting of the cells so that you will get the idea how much cells you are seeding. If your pipette tip touches anywhere while doing the process, you need to change the tip to avoid contamination or cross-contamination between the tubes. Now you need to resuspend the pellet completely. The shear force of the mixing should be adjusted in such a way that the cells should not get damaged, but the clumps should not be there, and the cells should be suspended completely in its singular form. Now this cell suspension is having a 2 ml of volume, slightly more than that because we have suspended the pellet. Small quantity from this suspended cells we are going to take on a slide called as Nubar chamber. The slide is also called as hemocytometer, which is used for counting of cells. You can see the slide is engraved. Calculation will be explained later. Now we are loading. Now we are going to seed the cells in two tea flasks, 25 ml. You can see we have pre-labeled the flask with the passage number N40. Previously it was N39. The cell line number A549 and the date and the flask numbers. We have 2 ml of the seed culture. So we are going to add 1 ml in both the flasks. While pipetting the cells, care should be taken that the cells should be properly suspended and they should not be deposited at the bottom of the tube. So you need to mix them first slowly with a controlled shear pressure and then take 1 ml of quantity and add it in a tea flask. While adding in a tea flask, care should be taken that the cells should not get attached at the other parts of the flask except the bottom. Neck area should be taken care of, which should be free from any traces of media or the cells because it is more prone to contamination. Now we are going to add a complete medium for the growth of these cells. T25 flask is called as T25 because we can add up to 25 ml of media, but we are going to observe these flasks after 24 hours and 48 hours. So we are adding total 5 ml of volume. 1 ml we have already added with the cells and now we are going to add 4 ml in each flask. So total volume becomes 5 ml. Now the mixing of the contents of the flask should be done to make sure that the cells are uniformly distributed in the flask and will get attached at the bottom for their growth. Now the medium has pH 7, so the indicator phenol red. You can see a proper red color of the medium because of the indicator phenol red, which will go on changing as the cells will start metabolizing. You can mix the contents by forming the infinity shape of the flask and making sure there shouldn't be any clumps of the cells inside the medium and cells should be in the singular form. Now our flasks are ready for the incubation. After incubation of 24 hours, we are going to observe the growth of the cells which we have passaged yesterday and we will observe whether our cells have grown properly or not. After 24 hours of incubation, now we have adjusted the flask at 10x magnification. Now on the screen you can see the cells have started to attach at the bottom. These spike shaped cells are the one which are near about fully grown cells, and the circular cells are still partially suspended in the medium. They will get attached at the surface and start growing or multiplying. So we can say that still the monolayer of the cells is not formed after 24 hours. So this flask needs further incubation to get the monolayer of the cells. So we are going to incubate this flask again after 48 hours. Now we are going to take out the flask from the incubator to check whether the monolayer has formed or not. If you carefully see the color of the medium, it has changed towards a pink shade. That means the cells have metabolized completely. Now I am going to adjust this flask under the microscope. To see the monolayer formation. Now after adjusting at 10x, you can see on the screen the monolayer has formed, and you can clearly see the difference between the growth after 24 hours and after 48 hours. These spindle shaped cells which are attached completely at the bottom are fully grown cells, and other cells are still in the growing phase. We'll increase the magnification to further see the morphology of the cells. Now here, as you can see clearly, the spindle shaped completely grown cells are attached at the bottom, and there is a complete monolayer of the cells. After observing the cells, their growth after 48 hours, now we are going to proceed for the next step in animal tissue culture. Now in the next step, we are going to freeze the cells. Once you achieve the required growth of animal cells after 24 hours or 48 hours, or in some slow growing cells after 96 hours, you can use these cells for your experiments, like different types of assays, cytotoxic assays for example, MPT assay, or you can use them for the experiments like study of some protein or gene expressions, or which regulates or which gets upregulated or downregulated with response to some drugs, or to study the safety studies of drugs. Otherwise, you can preserve these grown cells for further use. These cells can be preserved for different time intervals, like from 1 month till years, depending upon the method which you are going to use for the preservation. The animal cells are very sensitive for preservation process. The cell recovery percentage is very less as compared to the microbial cells. Today, the freezing process which we will be using is preservation at minus 80 degrees Celsius. This keeps the cells in the preserved state maximum for the duration of 1 year. After that, the maximum cells viability is lost. If you want to preserve them for a long term, they are preserved in a liquid nitrogen at minus 195 degrees Celsius. So today we are going to see the procedure for preserving the cells at minus 80 degrees Celsius. Now we are going to remove this media and resuspend the cells by trypsinization. After 5 minutes of incubation, we are taking the flask out. The trypsin has done its job. The cells are now detached from the surface and from each of the The centrifugation is done. Now we are going to take out the tube and look for a cell pellet. If we observe carefully at the bottom of the tube, the cell pellet can be seen. Now we need to remove the media and the diluted trypsin, that is the supernatant, after centrifugation. So now we are discarding the supernatant. Very slowly we have to take out the supernatant without disturbing the pellet. We are using micropipette of 1000 microliter. Sterile tips. While taking out the media, the suction should be done from the walls of the tube and not from the center, so that the pellet will not get disturbed because of the pressure generated by the pipetting. Now you can see the pellet is settled down at the bottom. Media and the trypsin should be completely removed. Now these are the cells which we are going to preserve at minus 80 degrees Celsius. For preserving these cells, we are going to add two components or resuspend the pellet in two components, the fetal Bowen serum, and that is FBS and DMSO, that is dimethyl sulfoxide. FBS is going to provide a natural environment for the cells in the preserved state, and DMSO is going to protect or stabilize the cell membrane at lower temperature. Before adding DMSO, first we are going to resuspend the cells in FBS, and after resuspending the cells, we are going to count the cells to determine how much number of cells we are preserving, so that after revival we will get the idea of percent viability of the cells after preservation. So now we are resuspending the cells. We are going to take a small quantity of a sample on Nubar chamber for counting the cells. In the remaining suspended cells, which has a volume of 2 ml, we are going to add DMSO. The ratio of DMSO and the cells should be 9:1, that is 9 parts of cells and 1 part of DMSO. These are our suspended cells in FBS. The vials are kept in a box, called as cryo box, used as a holder to hold the vials. We are going to add 100 microliter of DMSO, that is dimethyl sulfoxide. You can use a smaller pipette, micro pipette of the capacity 20 to 200 microliter for taking out 100 microliter. So we are adding 100 microliter of DMSO now in both the vials, 100 microliter each. So now our cells are ready for the preservation by freezing at minus 80 degree. We are not going to keep these vials directly at minus 80 degree Celsius because the major constituent of the cell is water. So if the temperature suddenly decreases, then the water crystals get formed inside the cell. These crystals can damage the cell membrane and ultimately leads to cell death. We are going to keep this box in a normal fridge which has a temperature range from 5 degree to 10 degree. The temperature is 5 degree Celsius and we are going to wait till our cells or the vials achieve this temperature. Then we are going to transfer it on the upper part which will have a temperature approximately minus 4 degree Celsius. Approximately after 2 hours, we are going to check the temperature of the vials. The temperature achieved is near about 5 degree. So we are going to transfer this box on the upper part of the fridge. After 1 hour, now we are taking out the cells. And you can see whether the cells are frozen or not. So you can see the complete content is frozen. Now we are going to transfer this box in minus 20 degree freezer. This is a minus 20 deep freezer. You can see the temperature achieved here is minus 20 degree. Now we are going to keep our box which contains vials at minus 20 degree Celsius for 2 hours. After 2 hours, we are going to take out the cells. Now we are taking out the cells from minus 20. So you can see we are decreasing the temperature step by step. And we are going to transfer this box in a deep freezer whose temperature is adjusted to minus 80 degree Celsius. Now we have kept the cells at minus 80 degree Celsius. While reviving the cells, you don't need to go back to the steps which we have done for freezing. Directly you can thaw the cells at 37 and revive.